Good evening, everybody. Everybody see me? Hello. Babe, I think you might have made yourself spotlight. All right. Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for joining. Thank you so much for being on time. If you want to send a message out to anybody who's not, you know, who's coming, who's not logged on, if you want to just be like, to join. One second, I'm having people message me to say passcode. Did you guys need to do a passcode to get in? Sorry, I'm just some people from my church want to log in. Anyway. Okay, we'll get started. There's 21 people on the call. I really appreciate your time. I want to respect your time. And it's about sleep, so I don't want it to go too late. So let us begin. I'll start off with a question. I was listening to a sermon by Bishop T.D. Jakes, and it was just a snippet that he said. And he said, we talk too much about generational curses. When you start talking about generational blessings, now everybody's got like a family dynamic, but I want you to put in the chat box just something that your family has helped you learn or know. Something that you're grateful for, that you've learned in your family, that you're thankful that you learned there. It could be anything, it could be tenacity, could be resilience. Could be business, it could be kindness. So put something in the chat box that you are grateful that you learned from your family. To share, okay. That's a good one. So we have kindness that I'm worthy and can achieve even if those around me are not achieving. Yeah. Sorry, the question was, I was listening to something and it was talking about we spend too much time talking about generational curses. We don't talk enough about generational blessing. So my question was, is there anything that you've learned from your family that you wanted to share, that you're grateful for, that your family learned, taught you? Humility, kindness, the importance of family, to help others in need, satisfied with what you have, respect. These are all really good. Really, 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 really good. Okay, so you're not here to talk about that. You're here to talk about, to be thankful. Fantastic, fantastic. So I want you to welcome you to this month's, and the first one this year, the installment of Health is Wealth. I always like to start these presentations with thank you. Why do I say thank you? So first thing is, anybody who's logged on now and anybody who is watching the recording, you could have been anywhere, you know? So I'm grateful that you're here spending the time with me. I want to, this is under the auspices of AME Finance, and it's been open to the world. So I want to thank Des, AME, the founder. I want to thank the AME Finance leadership. I always want to thank Manlight Rex because of his introduction to me in this space. I'm very, very grateful for the opportunity. I want to thank my team, the Master Builders. That's what we call ourselves. I want to thank everybody else who is here. So anybody from church, anybody who's heard, again, logged on live and listened to the recording. I'm very grateful that you have taken the time to spend time with me to talk about this issue, sleep and sleep issues. Now, who am I? I know it's taken me a while to get to introduce myself. My name is Ayo Olatoye, and I'm many things. So what am I? I'm a Christian. I am a husband. I am a father. I'm a son. I'm a brother. I'm a cousin. I'm an uncle. I am a doctor. I'm a consultant in acute medicine. I'm a musician. You know, I'm lots of things. And you're lots of things as well. But the first mover for this was I had a stroke in June 2020 while I was at work. And as a consequence of that, I started to be much more intentional about my health in a way that I wasn't before. And again, I'm a doctor, so but they always say doctors make the worst patients. I started to be much more intentional about my health. And as a consequence of spending time off, I started asking myself the question, I've got to find ways of making money and increasing my means that don't involve trading time for money. That's why I'm grateful to Rex, because he introduced me to AME Finance. And that's when I started my journey towards financial freedom. And I want to stress that I was working before, but I don't think necessarily I was working towards financial freedom. I'm a master builder. As these conversations progress during the year, I think it'll become more relevant specifically what that means. Okay, so for these kind of conversations, I always like to establish some ground rules. So the first ground rule is I'm your brother. I say that because sometimes when we're having conversations about health and challenging people, the truth can be challenging, and I want people to remember that it's coming from a place of love. I'm your brother. That's why I'm saying the things that I'm saying. And I'm saying it because I want the best for you, you know. There are some situations where you might think that somebody is advising you something and it benefits them. This isn't that. There's actually there's no way that you being healthier benefits me. Just as I've started to walk down this road, it's become clear to me that there's no such thing as something for nothing, I should say, rather than something for nothing. And progress comes at a cost. These are just some things that I think, and the views in which I look at the whole world. And back to some ground rules. So we've had conversations before, if you've seen in the previous Health is Wealth, but this is my thing. Take stock, take responsibility, take action. That's what I did when I joined AME Finance, because I took stock of where I was financially. I took responsibility for where I was financially, and I took action to start to move myself forward. So many people haven't even answered the question, where am I in life? And where so many people were blaming other people for the position that we're in, and, you know, we are where we are from because of the choices that we're making. And sometimes we've even acknowledged where we are and we don't like it, but we're not taking any action to move forward. And one of the big things I like to do with these conversations is just to encourage you to just change one thing. Change one thing, I'm beginning to walk in that direction. And trust me, with the consistency, things will be added to the journey to make life easier for you to achieve the goal that you're trying to achieve. So I also think it's important, again, when we're talking about health, last time we did this, I talked about, so historically, there was a greater understanding of the fact that we as human beings are body, soul, and spirit. And it was described by our ancestors as a state of ease when all these things were in balance. And when these things were not balanced, we were in a state of dis-ease. That's where the word disease comes from. I think it's important because even if you were to consider, even if you didn't want to, you know, consider body, soul, and spirit, it's important to understand that the body itself is interconnected. One part informs another part. And we're talking about sleep here, but there are so many other things that influence our ability to get a good night's sleep. So what am I hoping that you're going to get from this? I would like everybody to have a greater appreciation of what sleep is and the benefits of sleep. During my research for this talk, I was really struck by some of the things that even I didn't know in terms of the restorative and positive properties of a good night's sleep. During these conversations, we're going to review things that are an enemy of a good night's sleep. And the reality is that we're not going to cover all of this in 1 hour. This is why this is part one. I'm going to go for as long as I think is reasonable today, and then we're going to book a part two. We're not going to cover everything today. I think it's important to stress that it's too much to cover every topic that we discuss. There are reams and reams and reams of research or books on our TED Talks. And we're going to do a whistle-stop tour of solutions to problem sleeping when we get there. I really want you to leave this set of conversations viewing sleep as an asset class rather than, oh, sleep is a thing that, you know, I have to get through to get to tomorrow, or sleep is a thing I do at the end of the day. To really be intentional and appreciative of a good night's sleep. See, as an asset class. Now, the majority of people who are here are trying to do things to better their life. We understand the concept of asset class and how we research and how we invest in assets. And I want you to see sleep like that. Why am I doing this? You know, it's good to give. I was taught that. That's one of the things I learned from my family. I truly believe this. A rising tide raises all boats. Now, what does that mean? There are certain conversations you have with certain people in certain circumstances where you get the impression that certain people are concerned that raising somebody else diminishes them. I don't believe that. I believe it's possible for us all to raise, to rise, and it be a benefit to everybody. So that's part of the conversation, part of my motivation for doing all the things. And again, we're talking about good quality sleep. There is a conversation to be had about quantity, but I really want to stress the quality of sleep. And then we'll talk about what makes good quality sleep as these talks progress. So I hope everybody's followed me so far. Now, it's a big issue. Let's take stock. Sleep. 2/3 of UK adults suffer from disturbed sleep. So if you're in a room full of 3 people, at some point, 2 of those people have had an issue with disturbed sleep. It's a big issue. Nearly a quarter of people surveyed report no more than 5 hours sleep a night. And a quarter of people report that improving sleep has been an aim for them at some point or currently. I'm sure some of us can relate. If you can relate, put it in the chat box. Is that you? Have you thought about what you can do to improve your sleep, or has it bothered you that you haven't had as good sleep as you'd like? The average, and again, I believe this is the mean average, adult in the UK gets 5 hours sleep a night. Women are hit harder than men. On average, they're getting 1 hour less sleep a night on average. And again, back to taking responsibility and taking action, more than half of the people surveyed have identified poor sleep as an issue, but aren't doing anything about it. Now, you guys are not in that group because you're here in this talk listening to me. So, what is sleep? Have you ever, because as I was doing some research, I was thinking, like, how would I, and we all do it, but, you know, how would you, if you met an alien who didn't sleep, how would you describe it to them? So here's a definition of sleep. Sleep is a naturally recurring state of mind and body, characterized by altered consciousness, relatively inhibited sensory activity, reduced muscle activity, and inhibition of nearly all voluntary muscles during rapid eye movement sleep, and reduced interactions with surroundings. So that's, you know, you could, that's a pretty long-winded way of describing what sleep is. Another way of describing what something is by saying what it's not. So sleep is the opposite of wakefulness. We're all awake now, I would hope, on this Zoom. And what's wakefulness? So wakefulness, again, is a daily recurring brain state and state of consciousness in which an individual is conscious and engages in coherent cognitive behavioral response. So cognitive or cognition is thought. To the external world. Being awake is the opposite of the state of being asleep, in which most external inputs to the brain are excluded from neural processing. I hope that makes sense. So we know what sleep is, and we know what wakefulness is. Now, let's go a bit deeper. There are four stages of sleep, and these stages of sleep are determined by our assessment of brain waves. So when you have an EEG, an electroencephalogram, that's looking at the brain waves emitted, there are four stages. Stage one, N1. Essentially, it's just that dozing off period. It's not very long. That's about 5 minutes. In that stage of sleep, it's very easy to get woken up. And it's in this stage. But you know, sometimes when you're watching somebody fall asleep and they might do like some sort of what we call myoclonic jerks, they might just contract. That's what happens in stage one sleep. It's essentially a doorway. Nothing major happens in stage one sleep. It's supposed to get you to stage two. So stage two sleep, N2, everything slows down. So your body temperature drops, your muscles relax, your heart rate slows down, your blood pressure drops, and it lasts, again, it can last between 10 minutes to 25 minutes. So we've got stage one, stage two. What happens next? Stage three, again, things slow down further. Now, this is when we get to the good stuff. So stage three sleep is where your body starts to do the things that we realize are the benefits of sleep. So having good quality stage three sleep helps us with thinking, helps us with our creativity, and helps us with memory building. There's some data and research to suggest that good quality stage three sleep also helps us rebuilding our immune system and strengthening our immune system. And it cycles through the night. So you go from, you know, up and down through these stages. So that's what this diagram shows you. You're not in any particular stage of sleep for any period of time, for any long periods. You don't stay there. You go up and down through these stages of sleep. Now, most of us have heard of REM sleep. REM starts for rapid eye movement sleep. Here, your brain activity actually picks up, which is interesting. And your brain waves are almost as active as when you are awake. But the thing that's important is that, so your eyes move rapidly. You can see under your eyelids, but your body is still. Medically, you have what we call A, the absence of tonia. Tone means muscles contracting and stuff. Your body is still. Again, good REM sleep helps you with thinking, memory, and creativity. Have you guys seen the film Inside Out? So in the film Inside Out, when Riley goes to sleep and then they send the memories to, I think it's up to the commission. Oh, Sean, you need to see Inside Out. It's a good film. That is a visual representation of REM sleep, where your memories get fixed. It's a good film. It's a very good film. And the majority of dreams occur in REM sleep. You can dream in any state, but the majority of dreams occur in REM sleep. Okay. Now, it takes about 90 minutes to get to REM sleep. So if you're going to have, if you're having a nap, you're not having REM sleep. This is the kind of sleep you're going to have over a long period of time. And again, if you look at the diagram, you start awake and then you go from stage one to stage two to stage three to stage four. There's a degree to which, if you, have you seen Inception? There's a degree to which the different layers in the Inception could represent the stages of sleep as we're describing here. Okay, so well done, Sean. You've seen an important film, but you need to see Inside Out. It's a good film. Okay, the benefits of sleep. Now, here we go. This is. I hope. I mean, if you want to make notes, this is a good time. This is where we're going to talk about sleep as an asset class and the benefits of sleep. So, I want you to finish this sentence. Don't it always seem to go? Let's see if we've got any Janet Jackson or Joni Mitchell fans in the house. Don't it always seem to go? Finish your sentence. Don't it always seem to go away?
That you don't know what you've got till it's gone.
Thank you. That you don't know what you've got till it's gone. So the reason I've put that on there is because I think it's human nature, but quite often we don't appreciate something till it's not there. Specifically in medical science, historically, when you look back at things, when people didn't know why something was there, or you know, it didn't appear to be doing anything, they would be like, oh, we'll just get rid of it. So for instance, historically, when people were having abdominal surgery for anything, they would just take the appendix out while they were there because it didn't appear to be doing anything. And I think our understanding of sleep is similar. So back to the appendix, what we didn't realize is that the appendix is an immune organ, and it does a lot of things when we're in our mother's wombs. And back to sleep, because of the fact that it doesn't look like anything is happening, I don't think anybody really realized that sleep was important. And a lot of the information we have about the benefits of sleep have come from when we have studied sleep deprivation. That's what we're talking about here. So, benefits of sleep. We'll go through them one by one and slowly. So it allows your body to recharge. What do I mean by that? Energy conservation. So actually, when you're asleep, you're able to save about 10% of the energy that you would normally spend when you were awake. Again, you don't have to regulate your body temperature. So that's one of those things. Your caloric demand is reduced. So burning calories is your body's way of producing energy. And the interesting thing about that is that there is some data suggests that your body's energy expansion and the rate that it does that is part of the aging process. So if you're able to slow that down, you know, then, and I don't mean aging in terms of 10 years old, now I'm 90, in terms of physiological age and your body's robustness and the robustness of your cells. Energy conservation is a big issue in that. So sleep is very important. Again, good quality sleep. It helps you stay healthy. Those of us who have, you know, houses or cars or whatever understand the concept of maintenance. I've put a note to talk about modern medicine there because the reality is that so I am an acute medic. If you come to hospital and your problem is medical, again, that's not surgical or kid stuff or women stuff. So things like heart attacks and strokes and infections and, you know, problem with your salts and stuff, you might see me. But modern medicine today is designed to deal with emergencies. And modern medicine is great if you're in an emergency, but it's not necessarily designed to maintain. It's not designed to help you manage things. A lot of the solutions we have for modern medicine don't cure in the truest sense of things. And there's lots of data to suggest that, you know, again, back to body, mind, and soul. And as a Christian, I believe that God's original intention was for us to live in such a way as to have balance, to give our minds and our bodies things to heal itself. So sleep is one of those things. It helps you stay healthy. Again, it helps restore your immune system. We know this because when we deprive animal studies of sleep, they lose their immune system and die. It helps you with muscle growth. So all of those people who are going to the gym and not sleeping, actually, you're doing yourself a disservice. I was watching a documentary and it was talking about Olympic athletes and weightlifters and stuff like that. So again, people who, their ability to use their body is their livelihood. I always say that if you want to learn something about something, speak to the person who does that thing full time. So if you want to know, for instance, a good car to do miles in, speak to a taxi driver because that's their job. So when you speak to an athlete, the person whose job it is to keep their body at tip-top conditions, they don't play with their sleep. And a good night's sleep and a great sleep routine is part of their ability to achieve. It's important to remember that wakefulness is catabolic. Sleep is anabolic. They're just fancy words. Catabolic means to break things down. Anabolic, you will have heard of in the context of anabolic steroids, which means to build things up. So sleep literally helps you rebuild what your body is breaking down. Again, specifically in the context of muscle growth. If you're going into the gym and you're doing exercise, especially if you're doing anaerobic exercise, your body heals itself whilst you're sleeping. Sleep is important to sleep, so to tissue repair. It's important to cognitive function. So especially those of us who are interested in achievement, it's important to productivity. There was a study. We looked at some surgeons who have been awake for 24 hours, over 24 hours, took 14% longer to do the surgery. And sometimes people are like, oh, well, you know, I don't need sleep and it's fine and it doesn't affect me negatively. And again, they did perform the surgery, but it took them longer to do it. And when they were finished, they were at risk of 20% more mistakes. So it's not nothing, you know. And again, if you want, these are people who the precision of the thing that they're doing cannot be overstated. You can't have a surgeon who just is average and is okay. They have to be really, really good. 14% longer to do the same thing as somebody who's just had some good night's sleep. Obviously, one of the benefits of sleep is that it treats tiredness. Now, it might seem obvious to say that, but I don't mean sleepiness. I mean tiredness. Now, there's some data to suggest that tiredness, the concept of tiredness, is a buildup of a drug called adenosine in your brain, and sleep helps you wash that out. If you drink coffee helps you stay awake because it's it blocks the production and appreciation of adenosine in the body. That's why caffeine helps you stay awake. Now, plasticity, right? So what do I mean by plasticity? So growing up, before I became a doctor and in my early career, there was an understanding, I suppose, if you will, that the brain, once it was damaged or once it was fully formed, didn't develop. So the brain you got when you were, you know, became mature, right, in your mid-20s, that was the brain, and it was just downhill from there. There was no regeneration or anything like that. The reality is that we know that that now is not true. Plasticity is the way that we describe the formation of new neural pathways. We know that because people who have had traumatic brain injuries or strokes or part of the brain that's damaged or dead are able to relearn ways of doing the thing that they're doing before. So for instance, the part of the brain, let's say somebody had a stroke, the part of the brain that innervates or that is in charge of moving your right arm is dead. But with the proper therapy, it's possible to regain function in that side because of plasticity, brain plasticity, and sleep helps you with that. It helps you with your ability to learn. Don't you just feel dumber when you've not had a good night's sleep? It's difficult to pay attention. What do I mean by brainwash? So this is a relatively recent discovery. I believe it was in 2015. So again, everything that we're learning about sleep and stuff, some of this is in real time. You've probably heard of the lymphatic system. Now, there's lots of essentially tubes all around your body that take things from here to there. One of those tubes are your blood vessels. So your arteries take blood from your body to the organs, takes it away from the heart, and your veins take blood from your organs back to your heart. Now, your lymphatic system essentially is part of your immune system, but it's also essentially part of your body's waste system. It helps you take toxins and waste away from the organs to a place where they can be detoxified. That's what your lymphatic system is, and we are fully understanding of the fact that you have that in your body. We did not realize that there is a similar system in the brain. So one of the benefits of a good night's sleep is because your lymphatic system allows your cerebrospinal fluid, that's CSF, that's the fluid that bathes your brain, to take harmful metabolites, that's just byproducts of function, byproducts of your brain function, away. One of those is called amyloid beta, and accumulation of this is linked to Alzheimer's dementia. So not having a good night's sleep doesn't allow your brain to wash itself and get the toxins away, and increases the risk chronically of problems in terms of thinking and ultimately dementia. Increases the risk. These aren't absolutes. Now, a good night's sleep promotes weight loss. So one of the things that happens when you have a lack of sleep is that your body produces a hormone called ghrelin, which boosts appetite. And it reduces the production of a hormone called leptin. And leptin is the hormone that tells you when you're full. So some people overeat because they have low levels of leptin. And again, you are making it much more difficult for you to control your weight if you're having poor quality sleep. I hope you guys are following me so far. Some other benefits of sleep. Lack of sleep increases cortisol. Now, cortisol is a stress hormone. Now, I want you to think back in your mind to what we talked about in terms of God's original intent, as per my opinion. Now, even if you look at before we had modern life, there wasn't as much things that were stressing us out. There's a big, topic and conversation now about anxiety and things like that. And we'll talk about it as we, you know, later, that there are so many things in modern life are mitigating against us being calm. And the problem with that is that higher levels of cortisol increase the risk of cardiovascular disease. So we know that, you know, Western lifestyle and things increase your risk of cardiovascular disease. But in general, everybody in life, as we're becoming more developed and all these kinds of things, and with, there are more stresses, more things to think about, all of these things reduce our ability to have good quality sleep, which increases our cortisol, which increases our cardiovascular risk. It increases your risk of stroke in a roundabout way. So, poor lack of sleep increases the risk of AF. AF means atrial fibrillation. What atrial fibrillation is a type of irregular heartbeat. So I'll explain. There's two parts to your heart, the top part and the bottom part. The top part is called the atria. The bottom part is called the ventricles. There's normally coordinated contractions between atria and ventricles. Contract. Let me just turn my... contract. That's normal. There's a pacemaker in the top part of your heart. By the way, this is what I tell patients when I diagnose them with AF. There's a pacemaker in the top of the heart that sends an electrical signal to a pacemaker at the bottom of the heart. And as that signal goes down, every cell in the top part of your heart contracts. That signal is, everyone contract now, contract. That signal is passed to a pacemaker at the top of your ventricles. Everyone contract now, contract. Signal, contract. That's normal. What atrial fibrillation is all the cells in the top part of your heart, the atria, they're being rebellious. So they just want to contract whenever they want to contract. So rather than having a coordinated contraction, you now have this. The heart is just beating whenever it wants. The problem with that is that the lack of coordinated contraction increases the risk of blood clots that form in the heart. The problem with that is that these blood clots can shoot off to different parts of the body to cause strokes and to cause blockages, let's say, in blood vessels other places. Now, that thing, atrial fibrillation, increases with a lack of sleep, which increases the risk of stroke. I mean, good sleep, good night's sleep could save your life. There's lots of evidence that's to say you're twice as likely to have a car accident on 6 hours sleep than an 8 hour sleep. So those of us who've been managing 5-6 hours sleep, and it's just the grace of God, boy, you know, that has been keeping us alive. Sleep improves hand-eye coordination, reaction time, and we've already talked about muscle recovery. It reduces inflammation. Now, CRP is one of the things that I measure as a doctor to talk about, to get a surrogate marker of how bad the inflammation or infection is. Interleukin 6 is a cytokine, which again is a hormone or something produced by the body in inflammation. Somebody drawing on my screen. Thanks for that. And all of these things rise in when there's lack of sleep. So again, I want you to understand, inflammation in itself is not necessarily a bad thing in the right context. If you have an infection, if you have a cut and stuff, the natural, you know, God-given response to that is to have inflammation because it helps to heal. But it's not a state we should stay in, and having high levels of inflammation just increases problem. And there is even some data from some lifestyle medics that a lot of our chronic conditions stem from an increased level of background inflammation. Benefits of sleep. Sleep reduces the risk of depression. Sleep releases endorphins, and Even those of us who aren't clinically depressed, you know, when you have difficulty sleeping, it just feels really, it feels horrible that your mind can be racing and stuff. And sometimes all that happens is the sun comes up out. You still haven't slept, but you feel better. That's anecdotally some evidence, but there is definitely some biochemical evidence of sleep releasing endorphins. Endorphins are your body's feel-good hormones. Some other benefits of sleep. Sleep reduces the risk of diabetes. Did you know that skipping one night of rest makes you as insulin resistant as a type 2 diabetic? Now, just very quickly, diabetes is essentially your body doesn't know what to do with sugar. So type 1 diabetes is because the body attacks itself, the cells that produce insulin, and then you don't have any insulin that you are producing, which is why immediately you go on insulin in an injection. Type 2 diabetes, your body is producing insulin, but the tissues, essentially they're deaf to it. They don't listen to it. They're insulin resistant. The insulin is there, they're not listening. Insulin's job is to take things into the cell. One of those things is glucose. And yes, so type 2 diabetes is a high level of sugar in the body because of the fact that the tissues aren't listening. And one night of sleep puts you in a state that is akin to somebody who has type 2 diabetes. Sleep helps you convert short-term memories to long-term memories. And again, you know that after a poor night's sleep, sometimes it's difficult to remember what happened yesterday, boy. Sleep helps you improve relationships. Lack of sleep reduces our ability to engage in language, reasoning, and communication skills. Now, again, it's a surrogate marker, but you need all these things to be able to interact. We've all heard about the term hangry, hungry and angry. But what about our relationship with our, you know, significant other or parents or children and stuff? We all know that we are less tolerant when we've not had a good sleep. Chronic, imagine what chronic poor sleep is doing to our ability to interact. Now, again, this is just a whistle-stop tour of the benefits of sleep. And again, in the context of when we have investigated the lack of sleep. So let's take stock. That list is not exclusive at all, because that's what we're doing with these health is wealth. Where am I? Where are you? Do you feel like you can hand on heart say, I am getting good quality sleep consistently? Most of us know that we've heard of things, that there are some things that we can do to be like, yeah, I could probably, if I was taking sleep seriously, I could probably do that. I heard somebody say, I think it's a quote from a film, you should invest in your shoes and your bed, because if you're not in one, you're in the other. You should get a good quality shoes and good quality mattress. You know, how am I investing in my sleep? And I don't necessarily just mean a mattress. I'm talking about in terms of changes, because the reality is that a lot of these things, we can make changes about, but we're not necessarily being intentional about it. Let's ask ourselves an honest question. Are my habits helping or hurting me, specifically in the context of getting a good night's sleep? Now, illusory superiority is just a fancy way of saying that essentially most people think too much of themselves from an assessment point of view. It's the reason why most businesses fail, because people don't get feedback, and we have an overestimation of our ability. So again, back to the situation. The reason I'm bringing it up in the context of sleep is that most of us are like, nah, man, 4 hours, 5 hours, it's like, it's fine, you know? Most people think that they are the exception to the rule when it comes to, you know, rules. I suppose the point I'm making is that this is hard evidence from data, from studies. It is a myth that you are as good a version of yourself as you could be if you're not sleeping well. It's frankly not true. And I don't want you to leave here and think he's talking to other people. No, I'm talking to everybody here on the sound of my voice. Everybody, it applies to everybody because I believe that our bodies are designed similarly in this situation. We need sleep. I don't want you to go away thinking about the fact that, you know, especially with grind culture, and we'll talk about that more a bit later. I want this to be, take responsibility for where you are, you know. Nobody is making you not go to sleep or wake up early and stuff, or, you know, not invest in it. Nobody's making you do that. We have to take responsibility. I am where I am because of choices that I am making. Take stock, take responsibility. And I suppose now you guys are all wanting me to talk about, you know, how I can get a better night's sleep, right? Is that what we're thinking? So that, my friends, is what we call a cliffhanger. So we are going to, like I said, there's too much. There's too much to talk about in one session. And I just thought it would be ironic of me, now that it is almost 10 o'clock, to continue talking about it so you guys can have a good night's sleep. We are going to continue. We're going to continue this conversation, definitely. But I want to remind everybody that whatever we say, whatever decisions you make about your sleep, you can do it. There was a time when you weren't able to drive and now you're a driver. Don't believe that. Especially, I speak to so many people who are like, oh my goodness, I can't do it. There are so many things that you've been able to achieve in your life and you can do them now. There was a time when you couldn't do it. So it's possible. A good night's sleep is worth fighting for. There was a time if you were a trader, you weren't a trader, and now you are. There was a time when you weren't as healthy as you could be. Nah, my man. Know yourself. That's what we're talking about, taking stock. Be kind to yourself and be patient. The reality is that, especially when it comes to interventions and change, most things in life that are going to make us better are going to be something small every day. But human nature is, rather than do something almost imperceptible every day, I want to do something big once a year. But success isn't achieved like that. Our ability to be able to get to the point where we're having consistently good sleep is more than likely, because, like, we'll talk later about sleep and tablets and stuff. The reality is that they're not the solution. I'll tell you that for free. So does anybody have any questions? I really hope this has been helpful. And again, what I wanted from this was for you to be able to leave and be like, my goodness, I did not appreciate how important it was to my body to get a good night's sleep. I did not appreciate that actually I am a shadow of myself if I continue to put myself in a situation of poor sleep. So does anybody have any questions?
I have a question. When are we going to get the answer to the cliffhanger?
Good question. So I am going to do another session next week.
Same time next week?
Yeah, I'm just looking at my timetable. Yes, same time next week. So, and again, the thing is, I'm going to try and do my best to go through all the solutions I've come through, because I've read 3 or 4, 5 by now books on it, and I watched TED Talks and stuff. There are so many things that you can do, but I want to make sure that I want to leave you with some practical steps. So yes, next week, same time.
Okay, I received this information via a group chat.
Okay.
So how can I make sure that I can get the information directly?
What was the group chat?
Oh, it was a WhatsApp group chat with like hundreds of people in it.
Which one? Is it Black Business?
No.
Okay, fine. Right. So
is it best to email you, or should I give you my number directly in the chat?
If you want to put your number in the chat, then I can take it down. I can make sure that you're aware of that. Anybody else want to do that, you can also do that.
So you prefer to WhatsApp it to me than to email, which is preferable?
Yes. Yeah,
absolutely. All right. Okay, thanks.
Thank you for your question. So does anybody else have any questions? How do you stay asleep for those who can't get to sleep but can't stay? So Nana will ask and answer all these questions. So we're going to talk about sleep disturbances. We're going to talk about insomnia, because it's not, most people who say they're who have insomnia, they're not, don't have dictionary definition insomnia. We're going to talk about some health conditions, some drugs that can disturb sleep. We're going to talk about and some practical things that you can do. So don't worry, just a week. And we'll get to some solutions. So if you have appreciated and enjoyed this session, please follow me on Instagram. My Instagram handle is @aolat. I'll put it in the chat. @aolat. I also have a medical one, which is @official.ybcd. I'll add, you will have some of the slides there as well. Yeah, so I often put like stuff on Instagram. I say often, I occasionally put stuff on Instagram. I'm trying to get a social media manager. And I've had some conversations on YouTube. If you YouTube me, it's official YBCD. Essentially, I think that in specifically the Black community, we're not having conversations about health, maintenance, and taking care of ourselves. And we really do need to take care of ourselves. And I learned that for myself the hard way. So unless anybody has any, the meeting ID next week will be the same? Yes, it will. Will there be recording of this session? Yes, there will. I will put the recording information on my Instagram and if whatever WhatsApp groups I've been sending it to. Any other questions? Okay, well, again, it's been my privilege. Thank you so much for tuning in, guys. I do appreciate your time, and I will wish you a good night of good quality sleep. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Good night.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Dr. Chairman does it again. Night, night.
And saying good night.